Okay, I think we'll get started. Welcome everyone. Thanks for coming to the HDNR seminar series. Just a reminder, this is ongoing, and this time of year we actually have seminars pretty much every week. So do come and join us. Next week is Andy Seidel, his professor from Ag Resource Economics, who will speak to us next week. So please come along then as well. This week we're really lucky to have Jeremy Bruskotter with us, who many of you know personally or certainly know of his work, I'm sure. So Jeremy comes to us from Ohio State and previously at University of Minnesota, I think I saw, and Utah State as well. And his work overlaps with a lot of work that many of us do, particularly related to human dimensions and psychology and what drives human behavior, particularly around conservation decision making and large carnivores, which I always think is a good lesson for graduate students, if in doubt, think the sexy. So large carnivores, in particular wolves, just to crank it up a notch too. So we're really lucky to have Jeremy today, who's going to talk to us, not surprisingly, about finding places for large carnivores in a human-dominated world. So thanks so much, Jeremy.
So first of all, thanks everyone for coming out today, especially on a Friday afternoon. I'm sure you have better things to do, like go to one of the wonderful breweries you guys have around here. They seem to be everywhere and growing rapidly. So thanks for spending a little bit of your afternoon with me. I appreciate that. And while I'm saying thank yous, I have a long list of thank yous, and this doesn't even nearly cover it, but some of my collaborators at OSU, collaborators at Michigan Tech, John Vucetich and Michael Nelson at Oregon State, some of the folks here, Jerry and Tara and Mike, who I've had chance to work with over the years, all of these folks, their thinking and their ideas have shaped my ideas over time. What if I've learned anything over the course of my career, it's that what we think we know is often being shaped by external forces that we're maybe not even aware of. And so I better give credit to some of these things, because all of these players have been external forces at one point in another, and they've been shaping my thinking even if I'm not aware of it. So thank you all. And I have to give special thanks to Terrestrial Wildlife Ecology Laboratory, which for those of you that understand like what a co-op unit is, the 12 functions like a co-op unit at Ohio State, and where we have an agreement with the Ohio Division of Wildlife. We work closely with them, and they've sponsored a little bit of the research that you'll see today, and have been great to work with over the years. So I'm going to talk about large carnivores, and in particular, I'm going to talk about how large carnivores interact with people. And to do that, and I'm going to focus really on the United States, and to do that, it requires a little bit of history and a little bit of understanding of how we got today, you know, how we got here from where we were. And so this is very much a Western story, so it's a story that I suspect all of you guys are more familiar with than a lot of the audiences that I talk to back east. So there were once a lot of bison. Some of them were where we are now. There were once a lot of ungulates, actually, across all of North America. In Ohio, in my home state, we once had American bison. We had elk. We had black bear. We had wolves. We had actually grizzly bear at one point in the state of Ohio. A variety of other species, all of which were extirpated. Our Ohio Division of Wildlife has done a great job in reintroducing and recovering white-tailed deer, much to the chagrin of a lot of agricultural producers, much to the happiness of a lot of white-tailed deer hunters. But we haven't gone much farther than that in restoring a lot of the species that were once present. We did a very good job as we marched westward during Manifest Destiny of removing large ungulates from the landscape. That's where we started. For those that can't see, those are bison skulls that are piled there. So we started with bison because they were easy, and we quickly moved on to elk and other species. And we replaced them with cattle. This is just a graph here that shows the extermination of the American bison. You can see once bison were spread all the way near to the East Coast. By 1883, really, they were left just in a few remnant populations. I think they went down to about 50 individuals before they were protected in Yellowstone National Park, the Yellowstone National Park Protection Act. William Henry Hornaday in 1889 talked about the extermination of the American bison as the descent of civilization with all of its elements of destructiveness. The buffalo was everywhere, overrun by man with a gun. Right? So we did this, we were very effective at it, and it wasn't just limited to bison. We replaced those bison with cattle, and after we replaced them with cattle, we quickly returned to, or we quickly turned to eliminating predators. Okay? Because of course, when you take the things that predators eat and you replace them with something else that they can eat and you don't give them a choice, then they're going to turn to eating that thing. And they did. And so wolves and bears, grizzly bears and cougar were significant predators on livestock during the late 1800s, and we systematically exterminated them. I put this quote up there only because it's from Theodore Roosevelt, who's often considered one of the fathers, at least the intellectual, at least the political father, if not the intellectual father of American conservation, right? So the wolf is the archetype of raven, the beast of waste and desolation. Okay, I think he changed his tune a little bit more toward the end of his life. This is relatively early on. By the time the 48th state was admitted into the Union, every single one, all but one, had established a bounty on the cougar. You can see how effective we were at removing these animals. Here's a little demonstration of that. These are wolf bounties in the state of Montana, paid from 1902 to 1930. Wolf bounties started in the late 1870s, early 1880s in the state of Montana. Early on, they had a lot of essentially fraud, people turning in pairs of coyote ears. That's what you had to do at the time. And so they put some measures in place to cut down on the fraud, and this is basically after, the 1902 was after the start of those measures had taken place. So that's documenting wolf bounty payments. Something to keep in mind here that I like to point out to sort of to audiences is this Western wolf population that we have sits at about 1,800 individuals in the Northern Rockies right now. About 4,200 animals were turned in 1902 in the state of Montana alone. So just to give you an idea of the scale that they once inhabited the continent. And then something happens, and this is kind of the subject of this talk. Something happens from that point in the late 1930s to, say, the early 1960s, where we collectively, our society, has some type of change of heart. Certainly our policies change. Many people have inferred that our attitudes have changed, that our attitudes changed over that period. But we moved very quickly from attempting to eradicate these animals, and really in the space of a generation, to starting restoration efforts. So this is former Secretary of Interior Bruce Babbitt carrying one of the first wolves into Yellowstone National Park. And inside Yellowstone National Park today, people are coming from all over the world to view wolves. They estimate between $25 and $32 million annually are spent. That's above and beyond everything else that's spent in Yellowstone. These are just people that come to see wolves. So this is an estimate by Duffield et al. It's a little dated now. That was back in like 2009. I was standing on the hillside. That's, if anybody knows him, that's Doug Smith there. He's the park wolf ecologist. And when you have the park wolf ecologist with you, or if you know what he looks like and you can follow him around, it's a lot easier to find wolves. Because he usually knows where they are. So these people are standing about 2 miles off watching wolves in the Lamar Valley. So we've done something remarkable in Yellowstone, but I want to make this point that what's happened with wolves is actually indicative of a broader trend. And we get into mesocarnivores and into medium-sized carnivores. Coyotes have moved into spaces that historically they never occupied in the United States. Grizzly bear populations are up in the Yellowstone region. Fish and Wildlife Service is actually trying to recover them, or trying to declare them recovered, I should say. We have, in my neck of the woods, we have increasing forays of cougar into the Midwest, where they were extirpated back in the 1870s. We haven't seen them since then. Ohio just had its first cougar that was trapped and killed 2 years ago. So we have carnivores appearing in places that even 10, 15 years ago, we didn't think they could live. And so one of the questions, and this just isn't, it's not limited just to the United States. This is happening across Western Europe. Mike and I were fortunate enough to travel to Germany for a conference on wolves back in 2014. Is it 2014? And they had just had a wolf that was using urbanized settings in Germany that had migrated in to that area. So this is happening with increasing frequency. And when carnivores come into contact with people, when we have these interactions, there are consequences. Sometimes the consequences for us are entertaining. Sometimes they're bad. For carnivores, they're almost always bad. When they come into contact with us, it doesn't usually end well for them. So there's this kind of compelling societal challenge, right? As we have these animals, we're trying to figure out ways to live with these animals. And the societal challenge is, how do you exist with animals that can kill us? We can point to other countries that have been doing this for centuries, for millennia, but can we apply the lessons from those countries to our modernized country? And that's part of the question that I want to tackle. This has led to sort of my research agenda, at least that I've pursued since coming to Ohio State. And I'm going to talk about two questions that are related to this broader compelling societal challenge, which is, what makes humans more or less tolerant of carnivores? These are framed, by the way, maybe not as real precise research questions for those of you who are taking Jerry's class and he's making you sort of create research questions, then operationalize hypotheses. These are pretty broad, so and they're purposefully so, okay? So you can't catch me on any little slip-ups that I have. So what makes humans more or less tolerant of large carnivores, and what factors explain changes in attitudes and policies concerning large carnivores and their conservation? This will be, I'll talk about other countries here and there, but it'll be largely limited to the US. So the first question that you might ask is, what do you mean when you say tolerance? Right? We've got to operationalize those concepts that we're talking about. So we can contrast tolerance maybe with what we know is intolerant action. So here's a wolf that was gut shot in Idaho back a few years ago. We can pretty easily all agree that that's an intolerant action. But there are other actions that people take that are much more common, and they're probably far more effective from the standpoint of actually changing policy. And those are political actions, so oppositional types of political actions. And we can contrast that with what we might call supportive political actions, or even actions that may not be supportive directly, but indirectly, say by generating money through tourism, we might consider those supportive elements as well. Or we might just say that, hey, you know what, tolerance really what it is, whoops, gotta hit the right button. What tolerance really is just being able to live by these things and ignore them. You can't see this very well, but this woman, this coyote's gotta be 3 feet away, and she's not even looking at it. She's staring off in the other direction. I can't even tell if she's aware that it's there. It's kind of amazing to me. So just being able to like share space with these animals and not whack them is maybe indicative of tolerance in some way, shape, or form. So my training really is like most of you, I'm trained sort of interdisciplinarily. So I have training in ecology and wildlife conservation and management, but my core theoretical area has been in psychology. And actually, if I have a lesson for any of the grad students in the audience, it's make sure your core, the foundation is strong, but don't spend too much time there. You know, make sure once your foundation is strong, you're not gonna find all the answers in whatever one discipline that you're in. So branch out. Once you get that foundation stabilized, if for no other reason than intellectual curiosity. But most of the stuff that I've learned that have been really lasting lessons have come from other disciplines since that point of completing the PhD. But anyway, that's my training. So my training is really understanding human behavior, and the focus, right, is understanding what goes on, that proximate mechanism. What is happening inside people's heads before that action takes place? So I'm thinking about proximate mechanism as opposed to maybe an ultimate or a distal mechanism, something that's causing maybe that judgment to take place. And we're going to consider some of that today too. So we might think about sort of social processes that are acting in the background that maybe shape how my judgment, or they shape my judgment in some way, shape, or form. And so we'll talk a little bit about societal change. Taking a look where I'm at. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to try to explain this phenomenon of tolerance using a very standard psychological explanation and in a very standard way that a psychologist would approach this, right? So I start with a theory, with some sort of theoretical lens. And the theoretical lens that I'm going to start with is one that comes from cognitive psychology and its risk theory. And so the proposition that I'll make here is that an individual's tolerance for a species is, at least in part, a function of the perceived risks and benefits that they associate with that particular species. And I've put a little warning down here. And the warning is that this sounds very rational. It sounds very sort of cost-benefit analysis, right? I mean, that's what it's invoking. But our judgments may be biased. We owe this rational actor model, this idea of this sort of rational decision maker, to Daniel Bernoulli, who gave us the expected utility hypothesis way back in the late 1700s, right? And this is probably economists' best friend, and it's the biggest straw man for psychologists and for social scientists of every other kind. We love to set up the rational actor model and then easily knock it down, okay? So the rational actor model, in lay terms, the hypothesis is that when outcomes are uncertain, that is when I'm making some sort of gamble, that the individual's choices or their actions are going to reflect those individual valuations, those sort of cost-benefit analysis that are expected to occur from that gamble. Okay, so that's the rational actor model. Psychologists Daniel Kahneman and Tversky, for example, have made a career off of showing how we are not rational actors, right? And so I like this term. I can't remember who you would originally attribute this to, this term, the cognitive miser. But Kahneman talks about bounded rationality, that we try to be rational, but our decision quality, our judgment quality is constrained by having limited resources. And so what people do is they tend to satisfice. They tend to engage our brains and our deliberative processes just enough to kind of make a decision that feels good and feels consistent with what we think and what we believe, and then we can move on and do something else, right? We don't actually sit down, even when you think about the process of buying a new car. How many of you actually sit down, go over all of the possible options that are available to you, come up with a value matrix, weigh how much you value each of those options, then look at all of the various cars and decide which car is the best car for you? No, you go to the lot, you show up, you talk with the guy, and you say, yeah, I like the red one, right? And so we all have decision shortcuts or heuristics that we employ that allow us to kind of make decisions easier, that allow us to save some of that deliberative space and processing power and use it for other purposes. So researchers who study risk have talked about two factors, fundamental underlying factors of risk. So you might call one dread risk, and the other one, unknown risk. And both of these are things that inflate our judgments of risk. So we can think about risk in a very critical term, a very critical way, as an assessed risk. So, and that would just be the probability of a negative occurrence, right? So we can actually assess the probability. Dread, whether something is dreaded or whether something is unknown or novel, are things that inflate that risk perception. So when something is dreaded, we tend to think of it as riskier than it actually is, okay? When something is novel or unknown, so something like terrorism gets all of the play, right? I was in the hotel this morning working out, and I had the television on, and all of the talk was this terrorist attack that had happened in London and how horrific it is. It's all over the news. The news stories are just story after story, and expert after expert are talking about terrorism. But terrorism kills relatively few individuals compared to, say, heart disease, right? And how much coverage does heart disease get on the news every night? Okay? So we tend to focus on these things that we dread. The other factor, unknowable, unobservable, unknown, new, novel risks, that tends to inflate our risk perceptions as well. Think about something that, actually when I made this slide, swine flu was relatively new, so it's kind of not all that new anymore. So think of whatever new, whatever latest disease has popped into the imagination. But where do carnivores stand? Certainly we can say that they invoke dread. The idea of being eaten alive, I think, invokes dread no matter who you are, right? So that's an easy one. In the US, as opposed to, say, in Kenya, right, I would argue that they also invoke this sort of novelty factor as well, okay? Because in many cases, especially in the case of like Yellowstone National Park, this is a novel risk. It's a risk that had been removed back in the 1930s, and nobody has had to deal with it since then. So we're used to talking about carnivores. When you talk with wildlife professionals, we're used to talking about carnivores and risk, and we talk about risk beyond just threats to human life, right? So we talk about threats to pets or livestock or valued games, and these may look gruesome, but if you hang around carnivore conferences long enough, let me tell you, these are nothing. You should see some of the stuff that these guys have. And this is just to show you as much as we tend to focus on in the US, we tend to focus on game and pets and other types of risks. There are real risks to people. And these risks, I will say, you'll often hear people say things like, no one's been killed by a healthy wolf in North America in the past 100 years. Well, it's not actually absolutely true, and it certainly wouldn't be true if we had wolves in all of the places that we possibly could have wolves. Okay, one of the reasons why wolves aren't killing anyone is because wolves are in the godforsaken places where people never go. That's where we put them, quite deliberately, or where we couldn't kill them off. So this all starts with a survey that we conducted back in 2009. The Ohio Division of Wildlife wanted to contract Mark Duda, and they said, we just want someone to tell us if people will support hunting for bears. You know, we think bears are going to recover pretty soon. We want to know if people will support that. And I said, well, I think I can do something a little bit better than that that might be able to get you some more information. And I think we can do it for about the same price. So I had to do a little bit of convincing, but that launched the study of tolerance for bears. It was a rather large-scale study. These were our different strata, these different regions. Each one of those black dots represents somebody that was sampled. So there were about 2,900 respondents. In the analysis that I'll show you, use structural equation modeling, though I'm going to spare you a lot of the details of that. So here's that rational cost-benefit analysis. Here's what hazard models say. Okay, people are going to make this judgment based upon perceived risks, perceived benefits. It's a relatively straightforward thing. We get precisely what we expect. We get a relatively strong relationship between perceived risks and perceived benefits and acceptance of the hazard. In this case, the hazard is black bears. We're explaining decent amounts of the variation. We're getting fit statistics that you all would like. One of the things that I want to point out to you here is this correlation right here, and it's an important one. It's this idea of cognitive consistency. It points out this idea that people have a hard time judging something simultaneously as risky and beneficial. If we see something as risky, it becomes not beneficial, right? If we see something as highly beneficial, we want to see it as not risky. It's part of this, like, this cognitive consistency principle that Leon Festinger pointed out, you know, way back in the 1960s, right? We want to maintain that simplicity in our minds. Here's where the model actually gets more interesting, because the rational cost-benefit analysis, if you're like me, doesn't interest you all that much. Where it does become interesting is where we think about what factors might bias those judgments. Okay, and so they might be biased by things like social trust. We find significant relationships, though relatively weak there, with risk. With social trust, we find social trust is very strongly predicted by how, and this is social trust, I should say, in the agency that manages the hazard, so in this case, the Division of Wildlife. And to the extent that people feel values similar to that agency, their social trust increases. And to the extent that people feel they have the capacity to control the hazard or control the risk, their perceived risks decreases relatively dramatically. So we see a relatively strong negative relationship with there. We also see that control, that perceived control over the risk related with social trust and salient value similarity. Okay? So all these things are kind of sitting in the background. Yep. So this is our first foray. We also looked at the hazard models and we said we found evidence that people that are highly motivated may be making decisions based upon what psychologists call the affect heuristic. So affect is this quick emotive reaction that we have when we think about something, when the first thing that kind of pops into your head. If I put a picture of, say, if I put two pictures up of Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton, I almost guarantee you that everyone in this room would have some sort of negative reaction. Okay? Immediate, they'd feel it. You'd feel that that's the affect heuristic kicking in. Okay? And so we hear this a lot in the management literature, like, these damn people, all they do is they make their judgments based upon emotion. They, you know, they're not rational. If they would just be rational, we could get them to listen to our wildlife management options and make the appropriate decisions, meaning the decisions that they want them to make. And so one of the things was we wanted to kind of explore this idea of affect. And this actually, this model is much more consistent with what you see in the hazard model literature. And that is, it shows a much stronger relationship with perceived benefits. This comes up again and again in hazard modeling, that when people perceive benefits, when you judge perceived benefits and risks side by side, perceived benefits is almost always the factor that ends up explaining when people are supportive or oppositional to a new hazard. So here, the one thing I want to point out about this, we see strong relationships with affect going both to perceived risks and benefits. And beyond their sort of attitudinal acceptance of a population, we can explain their intention to engage in supportive actions and intention to engage in intolerant actions. And I should say, this is actually looking at a very motivated sample of people, and the core species here is gray wolves in the US. That's what we're asking them about. Okay. So one other point about risk, and then I can move on pretty quickly and get through the rest of this. So we wanted to show that actually, despite what some folks say, that you actually can manipulate. You can manipulate people's tolerance for hazards. There's a variety of demonstrations of this in the psych literature. So we basically took the sample of people that we had. We asked a subsample of those people that we had initially contacted, and we had their scores from the initial survey. And we asked them, we sent them a type of communication, and the communication was very strategic. It was designed using the very information that was provided by our local extension wildlife person, and that was available in things like the Be Bear Aware campaign. So that we used their own information. And we had these four treatments. We had a facts treatment, which we called the pseudo control, because it's just giving them general facts about bears. We had a treatment that would be the Be Bear Aware campaign. This is like how to reduce your conflict. And then we had two treatments that talked about the benefits, and these are broad benefits of bears, like they provide recreational opportunities, they ecologically disperse seeds and other things. So it's talking about kind of the broad benefits of bears. And then we had a combined treatment that gave all three. This is really briefly, I'll just show you what these look like. I'm not going to dwell too much on them. This is it. This is the whole treatment. So you've got them in an online setting, so we don't have them for very long. So and I have colleagues that say absolutely and unequivocally that you can't change attitudes. We heard from one of them, Andrew, at the Wolf talk, right? So absolutely and unequivocally, you can't change people's attitudes. Here's within subjects paired t-tests, and you see a significant difference in the treatment when we give people information about the sort of cultural and ecological benefits of bears, and in the combined treatment. What's kind of interesting here, maybe to some folks, is that this is non-significant, but what it looks like is we see a trend toward people that got that perceived control, the Be Bear Aware campaign. Actually, it looks like they're becoming less accepting of bears, or potentially so. So this is the bulk, this is the hard stuff to get through, then this is going to move a little bit faster. So what do we learn from this part one? This is me just acting as a psychologist, right? So all of this is standard psychology stuff. So what did I learn? I learned that tolerance can be parsimoniously explained by people's perceptions of risks and benefits. That's Bernoulli. He could have told us that in 1783. That these factors can be highlighted via strategic communications to influence tolerance. That goes against what some of folks are saying in the literature. Information about benefits of bears and how to control risk will be most effective in increasing tolerance. Information that only highlights how to avoid conflicts, think those Be Bear Aware campaigns, might actually end up decreasing tolerance. And if you're saying, yeah, okay, you've bored me to tears, all of this seems really too logical and rational, that's okay, because we're going to move into a lens that I think will offset a little bit of that. Okay, so we've been talking about explaining it variation across individuals, and what I want to talk about is like what affects kind of group level perceptions. And for that, I'll invoke a different theoretical lens, and this is social identity theory. And so, again, very simple proposition here: human tolerance for carnivores is rooted in group identity or group identities. To give you the lowdown, the very gist of social identity theory, or the core things that you need to know. Social identity is that component of oneself that is derived from knowledge of the group or the other. So knowledge of group membership. And this will make a little bit more sense when I describe these relative premises. So first of all, for social identity theorists, individuals, they believe individuals will seek to join groups that facilitate some sort of positive self-evaluation or emotion, right? So I want to be in groups that are going to make me feel good about myself. That's my primary motivation. They'll form positive attitudes about in-group members and negative attitudes toward out-group members. Groups always have a contrast group. There's always an out-group. If I'm a member of this group, there's always an out-group. And we can go through an exercise if you guys want to do that later that I use in the classroom. But and over time, and this is where it gets kind of pernicious and really interesting, over time, that strong identification with the group will actually lead individuals to form attitudes, beliefs, in norms that are consistent with that group and that are seen as prototypical of the group. What do I mean by prototypical? All groups have sort of a prototypical member, the member that everybody aspires to be, the paragon of the group, right? And so you want to be like Mike or be like whoever the leader is of that group. I didn't mean you, Mike, but but I could have, so. Social identity theory helps us understand how the interaction between groups and with the individual, how the group interacts with individuals in a way that basically creates intergroup conflict. And this, and I'll sort of, the easiest way to explain this is to kind of contrast it with our sort of rational interest-based notion of conflict. So in a rational conflict scenario, and this comes from, you can go all the way back to like realistic group conflict theory and the experiments of Sharif back in Robber's Cave, right? So rational interest-based conflict is pretty simple, right? I'm a rancher, carnivores kill my livestock, that's a risk, I want to get rid of that risk. I'm a hunter, carnivores kill the things that I like to hunt, that's a risk, I want to get rid of that risk. I am a wildlife lover, I love to go watch these things, you folks want to kill them, I see a benefit associated with them, now we're in conflict with one another. Okay, so that's interest-based conflict. In interest-based conflict, the idea is real simple, right? All we have to do is look for those win-win scenarios and we can overcome the conflict and we're done with it. So social identity theory explains in part why those win-win scenarios don't exist or they exist very rarely, right? If you don't understand that conflict can be tied to identity, the best thing that I can tell you, the best analogy that I can give you is a sports analogy, right? So I come from Ohio State, right? And I'm originally from Michigan, so I have competing actual identities here. But I work at Ohio State. During the fall, campus shuts down when there is a football game. And 100,000 people go to the SHU, the Ohio Stadium. And when Michigan comes to town, I'm not kidding you, students go through the entire campus and every M in every sign on every exterior building, they cross it out with tape. Every single one. All across campus, when you drive around, the M's will be all crossed out. Okay? The average student, the average fan who doesn't have money on the line and for these games, right, has no material interest in the outcome of this game. Their interest is in their identity, because the loss and the win implicates my identity. It implicates who I am. So sports are the easiest way to sort of understand identity-based conflict. And if you don't think it's real, think about the soccer hooligans and the people that die every year in Europe in fights at games because they are members of opposing teams, okay? I think if there's one lesson overall that my broader discipline brings to our collective endeavor of kind of understanding human behavior, the discipline of social psychology, it's that people are tribal, okay? We are tribal. That's what social identity theory kind of explains. And yes, in the environmental arena, we are tribal. And we have badges and symbols of our tribes that we wear, right? We environmentalists, I went to Utah State, and even within the department, there were the granolas, and then there were the folks that had the camo, right? And that's, Tara knows what I'm talking about. That was the wildlife department. There were the people with Birkenstocks, and there were the people with camo jackets. And they were different groups, right? And those groups had different beliefs. They had different belief systems. So all I want, if I get anything else across from you, I want you to accept this notion that group influences what we think. The groups that we belong to can influence what we think. And they can influence what we think about carnivores. So here's data that we collected in a 2014 study. This was nationally representative sample collected through GFK, 1,200 adults. And this is just showing you, this is the extent to which they identify with each one of these four groups. We actually did six different groups. And what you can see here is that if you identify with animal rights, that's this blue line, or environmentalism, as your identity with one of those groups increases, your attitudes toward wolves become more positive. As your identity as a hunter or rancher farmer increases, your identity becomes, as the identity increases, your attitude becomes more negative. Okay, so that's attitudes. What about sort of real world consequences? So I talked about beliefs. Here again, this is hunter. This is the extent to which hunters believe that deer or that wolves will keep deer, elk, and moose populations in balance. And you can see the sort of die off in that belief, if you will, as identity increases. Here, this is probably the most influential or the sort of best demonstration slide that I have. Here's the extent to which respondents identified as a hunter, and the percent indicating they would shoot a wolf if they saw one. Look at the last category above all those other categories. Group matters. And the groups, we get these signals. These signals are everywhere. Sometimes they're implicit. Sometimes we may not even hear them being communicated. Sometimes they're very explicit, like when they're communicated by elites. So here is what the director for the Utah Department of Natural Resources, the guy that's ahead, and it is a guy in Utah, it's always a guy, the one that is the head of all of the wildlife decisions, this is what he is saying about wolves, okay? And notice where they invoke the in and out group, right? So the goal of our anti-grazing, anti-hunting friends, if you can call them friends, is to end grazing and end hunting. That's identity conflict, man. It's about the out group. Okay, so those are a couple of quick lessons. One about that helps us kind of understand how people make judgments about wolves across individuals. One that kind of explains maybe how group might impact how we think and feel about carnivores. But the broader question that I started with is still unanswered. And that broader question is, how the hell did we get from doing this to doing this in a generation's time? And this, for this part of the question, I get to rely upon other people in this room. Maybe I should have Tara come up and give this part of my presentation. So we're going to focus on this aspect. So we're going to focus on the social processes that maybe sit behind our judgments. And I'm going to invoke modernization theory and the theory of the work of Ronald Inglehart. And I'm going to say that human tolerance for carnivores is a function, perhaps, of these changing social conditions that affect our values concerning nature and wildlife. So I'm not going to belabor this because I think you guys know it well. So Engelhardt and modernization, Engelhardt's scarcity hypothesis is basically this, that value shift is driven by resource scarcity. When resources are scarce, based on prevailing social and economic conditions, we tend to be materialist. That is, we tend to focus on sort of survival needs, basic meeting basic needs. When resources become more prevalent, we can move on to focusing on self-expression goals. We become more egalitarian in nature, and we become less materialistic overall. Okay, so the folks at CSU here have really been pioneers in adapting Engelhardt's theory to try to understand a little bit about how attitudes and values toward wildlife might be changing. And so they suggest that values concerning wild animals reflect these same or similar changes in social conditions. Changes that promote better conditions for people initiate a shift away from mastery or domination values that are focused on the utility that wildlife or nature can provide to us, and focus more on caring and compassion orientation, which is labeled mutualism, which you might say, and an ethicist would say, where wildlife become part of one's moral community. Okay, and I'm gonna borrow a couple of their slides just to kind of quick demonstrate this. So this is from the Wildlife in the West studies. Again, thanks to Tara for providing these slides. And this is just showing that, so the percentage of folks with a mutualist orientation, which you see over here, is strongly related positively with income, education, and urbanization. That is, as people's income, as groups of people, as states' income levels, education levels, and urbanization levels increase, we see a greater and greater proportion of people espousing this sort of caring and compassion sorts of values. And this is just to kind of demonstrate what that data looks like. And this is me pointing out, so this is the urbanization, and this is in 1915. I'm going to point to you towards some factoids here. In 1915, this is the year Congress first appropriated funds for the destruction of predators, $115,000, if you can believe it. That's all it was. Roughly one half of Americans lived in rural areas, and today it's less than 20%. It's about 19%, actually. So are these values or value orientations, are they actually related to our attitudes toward predators? So folks here have recently showed, these are survey items across a whole host of surveys that were done in those 19 Western states. And what you see here is the destruction of predators is negatively related with that domination orientation, negatively related with the mutualism orientation and positively related with the domination orientation. In our own data, and this is where I'm finally going to try to bring these things together, linking these ideas together. So can identity actually determine or shape or reinforce values? I like the word reinforce here. So here are two subdimensions used this one in the domination scale, this one in the mutualism scale. And I have all four graphs, I just couldn't fit all four in one slide. So, and they all look roughly the same, so I'm just showing you two of them as examples. Here's again the extent to which people identify with these four groups. Here I've actually swapped one group out and I've got the gun rights group here. And what you can see is that the value orientation actually is strongly related with their orientation with those groups. That is the extent to which they identify with those different groups. About one-fifth of Americans today strongly or very strongly identify as an animal rights activist. About the same number, 17%, strongly or very strongly identified in our survey as a hunter. How many people do you think identified as an animal rights activist back in 1915 when we appropriated funds for the destruction of predators? We wouldn't even known what an animal rights activist was, right? So it's not just the ideas that have changed, our groups and our affiliations are changing. Do wildlife value orientations, are they actually directly related to tolerance? Well, the best that I can do here is I can show you attitudes toward coyotes, wolves, and cougars, and I can show you the strength of the relationship with mutualism orientation, a positive relationship, and domination orientation, a negative relationship for these three species. I can also show you that their identity moderates that relationship. So if I restrict this to only strong cases, the strength of the relationship with mutualism goes up, not by a lot, or with domination goes up, not by a lot, but by a little bit. Suggesting that as I identify more and more with these groups, the strength of the relationship between values and attitudes toward predators actually changes, it increases. So can this idea of modernization, can it help explain the carnivore comeback? A few quick points of fact. So what I want to get you guys to do is to try and envision what it was like for someone on the Western landscape in, say, at the turn of the previous century, at the turn of the 20th century, what it was like for them in a daily basis to live. There was no interstate freeway system. There were no phone lines, or if they were just going up. There was no electricity system, right? There was no way to really get far beyond your community other than by horse and buggy. Or if you were going just straight east and west, you could get on a train. In 1870, 50% of Americans were employed in agriculture, directly in agriculture, not in the agricultural sector. They were farmers. By 2008, less than 2% of Americans are employed in agriculture. Think about what that does to rural communities. Child labor, that's not really a child labor thing, but you know, that's as close as I was gonna get. Before the federal government began regulating child labor and the Fair Labor Standards, this comes all the way in 1938, children were commonly employed in laborers, especially in the agricultural sector, right? They're still commonly employed as laborers in the agricultural sector today in some countries. Most recently, I can't stress how much the proliferation of these various technologies have changed, and I've lived it. I was about 5 years old, I think, when the Atari system first came out. Right? Does anyone remember the Atari 2600? Wes remembers. So the Atari 2600, man, that came out and that was cool. It had a joystick and one little red button and had little blocks that you could move around the screen and you could play games like Pong, and man, it floored us at the time, right? Now kids have these advanced video game systems. They can access games online. They can play multiplayer games with people on the other side of the country. They have access to hundreds of cable news and cable stations, satellite TV, cable TV. We have internet all the time. Most houses now have multiple devices on which you can access the internet, usually a PC of some sort, often a tablet as well. Think about this. Actually, the idea where this originally came to me, I was driving through rural Ohio, and I was driving past this small farm town, and there were these brownstones with these gigantic porches on them. And I thought to myself, I don't think I've ever seen anyone sitting on a porch. And if you know the sort of history of those buildings, one of the reasons why they had those big porches on them is because we didn't have air conditioning and the homes were hotter than hell in the summertime. And so they put the big porches on so people could sit in the shade, open up the windows and let the houses cool down. Think about how much our life has changed in the past 30 years due to technology. 87% of our time, the average American's time is spent indoors, another 6% is behind the wheel of a car. I submit to you that these changes collectively have dramatically affected risk. So now we're going to come all the way back to the very beginning. They've dramatically affected risk. And specifically, some colleagues and I, Mike was involved in this very recently, had a paper accepted, and we proposed that the mechanization of agriculture, the proliferation of technological conveniences, and urbanization and infrastructure development have profoundly altered risk associated with carnivores, actually in other wildlife. And that modernization, this is the question that we pose, modernization might actually be beneficial to some extent in those regards. This is a really complex model. I'm not gonna talk about it. I can put it up later if you wanna focus on it. This is all the really cool stuff, cool hypotheses that we're doing. This is what we have data on. the black boxes. So there isn't a lot of data on large carnivores. What we have is aggregated, it's IUCN data that's aggregated by a researcher at Oregon State University, a collaborator named Bill Ripple. And they were able to devise country-level metrics. These are, this is the proportion of large carnivores in each country that are listed by the IUCN as threatened or near-threatened. Here's GDP per capita. This would surprise some people, right? So as GDP per capita increases, as it increases, the proportion that are listed as threatened or near-threatened goes down. The relationship with economic development actually is positive with the proportion of carnivores. Now we can talk about all sorts of explanations for that. Like, we did a pretty good job of, like, the bubbles are a lot smaller down here. We've already eliminated some of our carnivores, right? I might counter that with the ones that are left are maybe less risky. Okay? So here's what we were actually able to test. We said that those three factors would actually affect carnivore conservation outcomes across the world. We had 128 countries. And here, for those of you that want to fixate on those, these were our indicators of these different factors. These came from World Bank data. So we had those for most countries. And here's the strength of the relationship. All you need to know, the top one is, these are just correlation coefficients. We can talk why we can't go beyond that in analyses in a second, but these are just correlation coefficients. This is controlling for GDP. Basically, what this is telling us is carnivore conservation outcomes actually improve, or the proportion of species listed as threatened or near threatened goes down, that's why they're negative, as these different risk factors indicate a reduction of risk. Okay, what does all this mean? So can modernization positively impact carnivore conservation? The jury's really very much still out. We can't rule out confounders in this data set for a variety of reasons. We can't conduct multiple regression. We need to account for net effects. So modernization has obvious negative effects on carnivores that have been well documented and other species. And existing data are simply insufficient to do that. However, we can point to mechanisms through which modernization might benefit carnivore conservation, specifically reductions in risk that might change how societies value and how societies think about what shapes our views about large carnivores. I put this disclaimer in here because Mike and I had this conversation multiple times. Context matters. So we're not claiming that there's a sort of a linear effect here that's going to be available everywhere, as a country modernizes, that it will invariably become more tolerant. Culture matters, okay? So the quick summary, because I know I'm running out of time. Sorry, Mike. So I've argued that three factors shape tolerance for carnivores. Risk and benefit judgments are important proximate drivers within individual drivers. Those judgments, in turn, are shaped by a variety of factors such as trust, affect, perceived control over hazards. So this shows us how psychological research can be useful for explaining variation within individuals or across individuals. Social identity theory helps us explain why different groups come to hold different types of beliefs about wildlife generally, okay? Identity acts to that individual, it acts as a reinforcer of beliefs, of normative beliefs and values. And it also helps to explain why intergroup conflict surrounding carnivores can become so pernicious in the West. Research on modernization and value shift actually helps us understand how changing social conditions across groups or across societies actually can impact how we come to value wildlife generally, and more explicitly, how we come to be tolerant, more or less tolerant of species like large carnivores. It may also help us explain why the US and Europe are witnessing this type of carnivore comeback. Last reflections. This is for grad students. Tolerance is really complex. If I would have stopped as a psychologist, I would have never learned a whole bunch of other stuff that became really relevant. If your goal is to study, as an applied researcher, to study phenomena, move beyond your discipline and work with people from other groups. That's got to be the primary lesson here. I am never going to be an anthropologist. I'm never going to be a sociologist. When I try to do work that invokes theory from anthropology or sociology, I try to involve people that know that theory, because it's, I assume that they know it better than I ever will. And with that, I just say thanks. Thanks for inviting me.
Thanks so much. I think we have time for a couple questions.
Jeremy, in the examples you gave about group and identity, they were crystal clear, and a person maybe was easy to put into that category. If you can talk about the fact that there's a lot of identities rolling around in everybody's head, and that whole process of salience of identity.
I know, so this is a conversation that Mike and I have been having a lot lately, and I don't know that we'll come to any sort of resolution on it, but so social identity theorists talk about it, in any sort of decision or judgment context, one identity becomes hyper salient, and it's the prevalent identity. This is actually something that I kind of disagree, and in part that may just be because I'm a very conflicted person, and so I have multiple identities and they become conflicted at points, and then I become this person that's like, oh God, how do I make this choice? So this is something that from my own personal experience, I have trouble agreeing with it. On the other hand, I can think of contexts like, for example, if one is a hunter and one is out hunting, as opposed to if one is a hunter and one is in a mixed environment, how that might shape the decision differently, because the norms of the collective group are going to be different in those contexts. So I guess all I could say is I think it's more complicated than social identity researchers, than just sort of that there's one, you know, one identity becomes ultimately salient and dominant over the others. But that's what they would say. That's how they would answer it.
Thanks. So at a higher level, how much of the phenomena that you studied here do you think are, how much are they influenced by the extraordinary development in the US of the sort of perception fields, marketing, insurance?
How much is which?
How much is that industry?
I see.
Because the US has really developed this management of perception. Risk managers are very powerful people here, as are insurance companies and marketers.
And I wish I had a great answer for you, but the best answer that I could give is I think as social media especially has come online, and now we're all like, where's mine? We're all strapped in, you know, 24/7 with our cell phones, and we're on social media. Actually, I'm reading this book right now by a demographer that was at the Pew Research Center that basically says the average millennial gets most of their news media from Facebook. That's where they encounter the news. And so you think about that, the way Facebook kind of spreads information, you're going to get news from your social network. And so you're going to get subject to ideas that are already consistent with your views, because the people in your social network are your friends, literally, right? So I think there's a lot of forces going on because of media today that we're only just beginning to understand. But I'm certain that that's a powerful force.
We have time for one more question.
Yeah.
This is a question which comes from my work in South Africa with lions and refugees and things. And it occurs to me, I learned a hell of a lot from what you were talking about. I'm an anthropologist and a social scientist. In terms of the epochs of capitalism, I think that there's a very distinct epochal shift that goes on where you get alienation and all that, but then there comes a moment, a sort of tipping point, where people actually want to be close to, proximate to, and endangered by animals as a kind of restorative gesture in a weird way. The people I work with in South Africa, the villagers who live on the edge of the Kruger National Park, are concerned about lions attacking cattle, but they're kind of, lions may also be associated with witchcraft. The students I've been bringing on study abroad programs to South Africa for 20 years have changed. They want to be closer and closer and closer and closer to dangerous animals, you know. And so I think there's something that the political scientists would say, we agree with you, that has to do with the history of capitalism and alienation, etc. When people want to recover something more primal by increasing proximity.
Yeah, that's interesting. I mean, I know folks have observed that. It's been a constant for a while. I was talking with folks in the National Park Service that have become just very worried about the fact that they have such large groups of people now that are approaching predators. So I was lucky enough to be caught in a bear jam at one point in a very bad situation. I was lucky because I was in a car sitting right in front of the bear. And so I wasn't in a bad situation, but it was in a very, it was part of the park where it was sort of in this cove of trees, and it was along a turn, and these people were jumping out of their cars because they heard there was a bear, and running down, running along the road. And what they didn't realize, because they couldn't see, is that bear was only 30 feet off the road sitting on a bison kill. And it was, so that's a very, very dangerous, and I mean, the park people were freaking out. And, but yeah, we saw this whole phenomenon of bison selfies in Yellowstone, like trying to get really close. And I don't know what that means, but they're definitely.
Authenticity.
Maybe authenticity, yeah. And I'm certain that it's different in different cultures too. But yeah, I could see that being a force.
Okay, well, join me in thanking Jeremy. Thanks so much.
Thank you.